Yeah, I'd like to add something, Mary. Actually, I'd like to add it for both you and Alice and Dan. I think we have three planning board members going off this year, terms expiring, and Alice, of course, has been a planning board chairman, as had Marion, and the time and effort involved in that undertaking is enormous. I don't think the general public really realizes what goes on behind the scenes in this volunteer board. The planning board has a lot to do, as you can tell by the size of our packets, but the chairman, and chairperson, I should say, takes on an added responsibility of getting this organized so that we have an agenda that we can deal with. And working with Steve Butler, it's a real arduous task every month to get through all this material and have it in an order that we can deal with. Marion has done a wonderful job over the past year and a half in doing that, and Alice, when she was chairman, did the same. And I think we're extremely fortunate as a town to have the kind of dedicated citizens we have that can take on these kinds of responsibilities. And I really applaud your efforts over the years, and you know you're going to be missed.
Madam Chairman, if I could just say a word, I will miss this a great deal. And I want to just say that I have found this to be one of the most challenging and yet rewarding boards that I have served on. And going into my 60th year, I have served on a few boards. And I also want to thank Steve Butler, who guided me through 2 years of chairmanship on this board, and the other staff that have been so helpful in the past.
Well, thank you, Alice. We will definitely miss you as a person. We will miss your expertise, your great patience, and we all think that you're a great lady. Thank you.
But don't get up and leave yet.
And thanks to Ivan for thanking me, but I will be here until after the March meeting.
Okay.
Yeah, but that's all right, Ivan. Thanks
well, thank
for
you.
Thinking of me. And I think I would have thanked Dan Boxer, who couldn't be with us here tonight, but I think Dan is going to be here through the March meeting, too, so, you know, we'll thank him the next time. Did you have anything that... It's all been said. Okay, thank you. Okay, I hear a motion to waive the reading of the minutes of our last meeting.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor, raise your hand. Opposed? Unanimously in favor. Are there any additions or corrections to the minutes of the last meeting?
I'm sorry, I don't have my minutes right in front of me, but there was a section, I think it was on the fourth page, which dealt with if I can find it.
On the fourth page.
I guess I will hold this comment for later, but there was a section which referred to the mallards and black ducks, which are on a pond in the Highlands. And the important thing, I think, that I asked Mrs. Stoddard was whether these were nesting black ducks. And I would like to have that included in the minutes, that she responded they were nesting black ducks. And I think that's important for the wildlife habitat review of that.
Good.
It's on page 3 at the very bottom.
Okay. And I had a question, and Mr. Frinsco, if you are here, the question related to you, and I think that we should set the record straight. On page 7 of our minutes, I know you don't, I will read them to you. I don't think I heard this, but it was after the public hearing, and we were talking about the connector road, the controversial connector road. And The minutes say, "Mr. Frinsco said that the fire chief has indicated his concern with the problems he has had with a limited access road." I remember your saying that. These relate solely to private limited access ways, which he feels the town has limited ability to enforce. I remember your saying that. But then, this says, "This applicant in the past has proposed a limited access road to be held by the public. For example, the rights to which are with the town of Cape Elizabeth, which cures any question of enforcement." I thought that I heard you say that that could be considered. Maybe you don't even remember.
That's a very accurate reflection of what I did say.
You did,
Chairman,
say that.
And the reference was to the comments of the fire chief and his concern that with respect to private roads, the town has no enforcement or regulatory power.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to clear the record, make it absolutely clear to the board that what we proposed was a publicly owned right-of-way, which the town then could regulate in a fashion it saw fit and would have the power to come in and remove vehicles blocking that right-of-way. I think the fire chief's comments were in the context of, if it's a private driveway, we can't come in and move vehicles out of it.
Exactly. But you see, my question is that I could never remember that the applicant had proposed such a road. We have asked questions about such a road at previous public hearings. And the town manager at one of the public hearings, I think I might have asked the question about such a road, a public limited access, and the town manager indicated that there could be problems with civil rights if such a road were proposed. And I cannot ever remember Mr. Kennedy asking or talking about any such road other than a private road. That was the only limited access that I can remember Mr. Kennedy proposing to this board.
Well, my recollection is clear, and in the initial stages, we did propose what we called a limited access road, which by its terms and definition, and perhaps we didn't make it absolutely clear, is a public way. It's owned by the town of Cape Elizabeth.
I see. We thought, at least I did, and I just wanted to get it all straightened out because it's a very important point. I thought that anything proposed previously was a private road. Okay.
Always public.
Great. Thank
but it was
you.
Always the option of the town.
Yeah.
We offered it as public. It was up to the town to decide whether they want to take it that way. Mm-hmm. We don't have that choice. We'll give you the choice.
Right.
The town will have to make a decision.
Okay.
Okay?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Very much. Anything else on the minutes? Okay, do I hear
Chairman,
a motion?
Only
yes?
That Mr. Frinsco's name is spelled with a K rather than a C, and that should probably be changed.
And incidentally, I would just like to take a moment to thank Alice Allen for these excellent, copious notes and excellent minutes that you take. And even though we do have questions about them, I just don't know how you do it. I mean, there are numerous pages, 17 to be exact, and these are excellent. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other additions, corrections, or comments? Then do I hear a motion to accept the minutes of the last meeting?
So moved.
So moved. Any seconds?
Second.
Alice, all in favor, raise your hand. Opposed? Unanimous. Okay, on the correspondence, I'm afraid that I have 5 pages tonight, so I will read as quickly as I can. Okay, on the 16th of February, a letter from Michael McGovern, which is an invitation to a board orientation, which all of you might be interested in attending, on Monday, 7:30 to 9 p.m. At the town hall. I think that's the 26th. There will be a 45-minute orientation followed by a board get-together chaired by either the outgoing chair or the incoming chair. On January 23rd, Michael McGovern wrote a letter having to do with the town council requesting that all board votes be shown by hands. That's why I've been asking you to raise your hand. I don't care if it's the left or the right, as long as it's the hand. And that the minutes record any negative votes by name. I received numerous legislative reports from Senator Barbara Gill of South Portland relating to public hearing schedules of the 114th Maine Legislature, including weekly legislative reports. On the 8th of February, PACS announcing a workshop on regional transportation issues on the 15th of February at the Jetport. On the 2nd of February from COG, the availability of a summary report on the first annual Congress. Then a COG flyer on a series of workshops on comprehensive planning. The next one is on March 7th at the Wyndham Town Hall. A letter from Michael McGovern concerning a workshop on the wetlands ordinance on January 31st. I did attend that. It was televised. I received a January newsletter from the Androscoggin Valley Council of Governments. On January 23rd, from COG concerning plans for a workshop on coastal issues. January 22nd, a letter from COG on sub-regional forums. January 22nd, from COG, more news on the sub-regional forums. The January issue of Maine Townsman. January, the summary of Vision 2000, a consensus for the future. January, an issue of regional news from COG. It was excellent. I just had to say that it was excellent and had to do with infrastructure. February 16th, a letter from Paul Frinsco of Bernstein, Schur, Sawyer, and Nelson regarding the final wetlands boundaries in the highlands at Broad Cove and the need to address minor amendments to the pending subdivision plan and wetlands alteration permit and the need to defer action on these matters until March, including a tabling of the public hearing scheduled on February 20th. February 3rd, Mrs. Frances Rice of 39 Hunts Point Road expressed concern about adding more traffic to Hunts Point Road and has expressed her concern for dissecting Hunts Point Road extension into three parts and her belief that the proposed subdivision includes the most circuitous routes she has ever seen, plus more. February 6th, a letter from Mike McGovern on suggestions for roadway and bikeway improvements for PACS. By June 29th, these suggestions must be addressed by the planning board at some point in time before June 29th. January 29th, a letter from the DEP from Marguerite H. Gatchell of 10 Bellfield, expressing concerns, 10 to be exact, regarding the wetlands in Stonegate Phase 4. A letter from Denise G. Sullivan on January 15th opposing further development of roads and property at the highlands of Broad Cove because of the destruction of wetlands and the possibility of high-speed travel in the area. January 25th, a letter from Mary B., I think it's Becker, who is a newcomer to Cape Elizabeth, concerning the native beauty that will be destroyed by further development at Broad Cove and the need for citizens to be heard on these serious matters. January 31st, a letter from George L. Higgins III, M.D., expressing the need for a second full access road for the Broad Cove area. He based it on safety, high traffic levels on Broad Cove Road, and the honoring of a town promise to provide a second full access road to the area. Two letters from Donald Webster, our fire chief, were sent to two associations here in Cape Elizabeth regarding the lack of plowing and the blocking of emergency access roads. And I have to commend our fire chief. He did a very good follow-up on the public hearing and concerns that were expressed on these emergency access roads. An undated letter from Dean Stoddard regarding the proposed wetlands ordinance expressing concerns on buffers and mapping. January 30th, a letter from Jane and Jonathan K. Lord of 3 Macaulay Road expressing numerous concerns regarding Spurwink Woods subdivision. On February 19th, from Peter S. Plum of Murray Plum and Murray, a memorandum regarding suggested votes on the preliminary plan approval for the Highlands at Broad Cove. February 6th, and it just arrived today, from A.E. Sturgeon Incorporated, a letter and information on survey services. On February 19th, a letter and statement from Rachel Perry, which just arrived this afternoon, of Broad Cove, listing her views on the preliminary plan approval, usable open space, and a trail system, and wetlands alteration permit for the Highlands. Steve will duplicate that and make it available to all members of the planning board. It was about 5 pages long and quite well written. Well, if I could take a breath after all that. Those were lots and lots of letters.
And that last item of correspondence I received in my house, I don't know whether the other planning board members did also.
I did also.
You did?
Mm-hmm.
So you all have that.
Well,
so
I don't know. I have.
You have. Has everyone received at his or her home a 5-page memorandum from Rachel Perry?
I don't think that's it.
Well, then I guess we'd better duplicate it, and just 3 of us have received it. Thank you, Ivan, for bringing that up. Okay, under old business tonight, first on the agenda, we have the Highlands at Broad Cove, a 20-lot major subdivision. We have to discuss, well, there is a public hearing or a planning board permit for the wetland alteration. We have to address preliminary plan review. And we should probably address, if we have the time, an amendment to a previously approved subdivision plan, which we have not addressed since we did not have the old previously approved subdivision plan. But we seem to have that now. So let us begin with the public hearing on the wetland alteration permit. Is there someone from the Highlands who would like to address this?
Madam Chairman, I'm pleased to report to you.
Incidentally, this is Paul Frinsko.
Paul Frinsko, I'm sorry, on
That's
behalf
all right.
of the applicant.
I'm happy to introduce you.
Greater Portland Development Group. Until I just got a 6 or 7 page letter from Steve Butler, I was pleased to report to you what was reported to me, and that was that your consultant, Norman Doe Associates, our consultant, EcoAnalyst, and a representative of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers had finally concurred with the consent of Greater Portland Development Group on the wetlands boundaries. And Scott Decker from Squaw Bay and Bud Brown from EcoAnalyst are here to show you where the consensus is reached and the mapping is done. By doing that, I think that we will resolve many questions and save a great deal of time. However, by agreeing to some modifications to the mapping, there are, I believe, 2 additional areas that were not addressed, and they are small, but they were not addressed in the pending wetlands application before you. They will have to be made the subject of an amendment to the application. The purpose of my letter was simply to suggest to you that we are willing to work with the planning board to find the most efficient way to use your time to address these modifications. Clearly, we will shorten the discussion and debate by agreeing upon the wetlands among ourselves, and we wanted to alert you to the modifications needed both to the wetlands application
and to the preliminary plan on which we are requested to reflect the wetlands also. To do that, since we didn't get the information in time for your deadline, which is, I think, 18 days or so prior to tonight.
Right. We just got the information this evening, too.
I suggested a possible way to do that, and one was to deal with the public hearing on the application that is presented, since those areas had to be addressed. Perhaps continue that public hearing until the next regular meeting of the Planning Board. Prior to the submission date, we would have the minor amendments to both plans into you, and then address the remaining areas. If there are further questions by that time, at the meeting of March, if that's appropriate, close the hearing and go on to deliberation. And I wanted to let you know, however, that since Scott, myself, and Bud would be here this evening, mm-hmm. we're perfectly willing to address any other questions in the preliminary plan approval process that you might like to deal with.
Good, good.
With that, I'll let the board think about the best way, the most efficient way to handle the question which has arisen. And I would like to ask now if Scott Decker and Bud Brown would review with you their findings and on the application with respect to the wetlands.
We'd be most
are we into the public hearing now on the wetlands?
No, not yet.
Oh.
No.
Right. What would you like to
hear,
cover first?
It's usually better for the applicants to explain briefly what they plan to do, and then, you know, that makes the public more aware of what they plan to do, and then we open the public hearing.
Oh, I'm sorry. But we are dealing with the wetlands application now.
Yes.
Fine.
Madam Chairman, are we going to have a public hearing tonight, or are we going to extend it, or should we talk procedurally about what we're going to do even before we get into it, so there's an understanding of
If you care to discuss that now, that would be fine by me. It's, you know, we received this letter from Mr. Frinsco on Saturday. I received it on Saturday afternoon and turned it over to Steve Butler as quickly as I could. I don't have the authority to cancel public hearings. We also did not have time to cancel the public hearing. And I certainly will go along with what the rest of you feel, but Mr. Frinsco's letter indicated that any changes would be very minor. So,
Madam Chairman, I'm rather surprised, considering past meetings and public hearings in regard to this, or just regular attendance, when Highlands has been on our agenda, we don't really seem to have the numbers of people that I would have thought might be interested in commenting, and I would be a little leery myself not to go ahead with a public hearing at this point.
How many, could I see a show of hands, how many people are here for this public hearing? I beg your pardon? So there are two of you, four of you, and this memorandum from Rachel Perry. It is surprising. I thought the hall would be filled, perhaps because it is vacation week. You know. Any other comments from members of the board on whether we should have this public hearing or what we should do?
Madam Chairman, I would think that we would want to open the public
mm-hmm.
hearing. But with the letters that came before tonight's meeting, there may be people out there who had understood that it was going to be either postponed or extended to our next meeting.
Mm-hmm.
So notwithstanding what happens tonight for holding the public hearing, I would expect that we would want to move toward the end of this to extend it to the next meeting.
Yes, we could probably consider the preliminary plan and whether we would extend simultaneously.
Mm-hmm. Good.
Well, what procedural questions do we have as far as the ordinances are concerned in terms of extending a hearing? Do we have a limit on that?
No limit that's specified in the ordinance. Ordinance is somewhat silent on the issue of extension of public hearings, and I'd asked Mike Hill from Tom Leahy's office to do a little bit of research, and he can speak if you like, but in essence, he felt that believes that legally the board has the right to extend the public hearing as well as table the public hearing. So both avenues are open, in Mike's opinion.
Okay. Mike, do you have anything to add to that?
No, I think it's within the board's discretion to extend the public hearing to the next regular meeting in March.
Okay.
Any other comments? So if you would proceed then, we will, after hearing your comments, open up this public hearing.
Thank you. I want to, we did not suggest to anyone that the public hearing would not be held this evening. We expected it to go forward. But we wanted to alert you to the potential and the need to amend it.
Oh, I see.
And that you may wish to have one continued public hearing on the application and the amendment, rather than going with two separate public hearings on two separate wetlands applications.
I see. Okay.
Scott or Bud, if you just review with the board what the changes are and what the final agreement are with respect to the wetlands delineation.
I'm Bud Brown from Eco Analysts. I think what I'll do is just review the premises that we worked on when we went out there, and then Scott will go through how that results onto the plan. Basically, I got in touch with Dave Cowan at Normando, and to get this thing on track, I said, why don't we go out together and look at the wetlands, and where there are any questions at all, whether we agree or not, we will make the wetland boundaries as wide as necessary, so there will be no question in anyone's mind whether or not they are wetlands. That was what we did. We worked back and forth with the planning board and with Steve, and Dave and I went out there, and we found areas where we could not make a decision one way or the other for sure in this time of year whether or not they were wetlands. And what we did was we made the lines wide enough, more than wide enough, so that there's, in my mind and his mind, and I believe he's communicated that to Steve, there's no question we have the wetlands, and they are on there as wide as necessary. And essentially, I'm just here to report that we have provided you an all-encompassing wetland line, which is, in my opinion, much greater than the wetlands that exist out there. But I think we satisfied the concerns of your consultant and hopefully the concerns of the board. And what Scott is going to do is address the plan. And I think you should keep in mind that these wetlands are probably greater in extent than they are by the definition, and we use the federal definition, which is accepted by the Corps of Engineers and the state of Maine, all the federal agencies, and in my opinion, it certainly encompasses the intent of all of your ordinances, both present and pending.
And you all agreed on this definition?
That's right.
Okay,
we use the three-parameter approach, essentially, which is the soils and the vegetation and the hydrology. Typically, one will find that it's difficult to have all three criteria, but that one or two of the three may exist outside of a wetland line. In this case, any one of those criteria was adequate to make the wetland line where it is, so that's why I say that it's undoubtedly wider than we would typically draw and what would be accepted by regulators. And really, that's all I have. I think that Scott will address how it impacts the development.
Good.
Unless you have some questions for me at this
Anyone
point.
Anyone with questions?
Yeah, I'm just curious. And given the conditions that exist out there now with the ice and the snow, what were your primary methods of identifying? Were you using vegetation or were you using soil types? How did you do it?
We used vegetation and soil types. There's actually enough snow on the ground so that there's not any frost unless there's been bare ground. So we dug a series of soil pits.
Okay.
And also, in terms of the vegetation, the persisting trees and shrubs, we erred on the extreme side of conservatism.
It's very difficult to map wetlands.
Okay.
Thank you, Bud. I'm Scott Decker from Squaw Bay Corp., and what I will do is very briefly show you the areas where the wetlands have expanded a little since the last meeting that I was here, and show you how the development impacts on those areas. Basically, in the phase one, the southern development, six lot development, a small area of wetland was added right here in this location. There were a couple of small areas added up here. Pretty much was it in the southern zone. But as you can see, the roadway that comes through from Two Lights Road to Hunts Point Road will have to cross a small section of wetland that was not shown previously. Up in the phase two development, again, right near the Hunts Point Road extension entrance, there was a little piece of wetland that was added to what was already shown on the previous plan. However, there's a significant area up here at the Heritage Court roadway. There's a 100-foot section right here that was not shown previously. This thin piece of wetland was broken. I believe it's in this location. It is now connected. So a short piece was added to connect that area. The perimeter was changed slightly down here in this area. And I believe that was about it. Little bulges, relatively insignificant with respect to the development, the roadways and so forth. I guess the only change from what we had submitted previously in terms of how we would deal with the wetland would be this section here at Heritage Court. And as Mr. Frinsko had indicated earlier, we haven't had a chance to address the design details of how we would address that. I suspect what we would do is put a short piece of culvert in here to ensure that there is no impedance of water and there's a free flow through the wetland. Previously, what we were doing is picking up the drainage from Coveview, running it down Heritage Court, and discharging it to the detention basin. And I believe we had a little field inlet here to pick up this water and route it down to here to the detention basin. We probably would not do that now. We would allow it to flow through. I believe those are about the only changes that would be required from the previously submitted drawings.
And you have no intention of reconfiguring these wide roads in any way to eliminate the impacts on the wetlands?
From what we had submitted, we haven't planned any changes. The previously submitted drawings reflect a variance in the town's ordinance with respect to side slopes on the roadways. The ordinance requires 5-to-1 minimum slopes. We're proposing 3-to-1 as we go through the wetland areas to minimize the impact.
Do you have any idea how many more square feet of wetland you will be impacting with these new discoveries? Because I did some simple math.
About a quarter of an acre.
A quarter of an acre?
About a quarter of an acre.
I did some simple math, and without these additional changes, you would be impacting 30,730 square feet, 0.44.
That's simple
yes.
math.
Yeah, no calculator either. It's the old-fashioned way. So if you take the 30,730.44 square feet, how many more square feet would be added?
About 10 or 12,000 square feet.
10 or 12, so now you're up to 42,730.44 or so.
More or less, yes.
That's a lot.
About an acre.
Yeah. It does, because you have to figure by square rods for acres. So it is approximately an acre or more.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Madam Chairman, just maybe to help illuminate some of the changes, Norman Associates did accompany their handouts with a map. It's a working map or a display map for us, and I could first put it out here so members could see it, and then maybe have Scott and I hold it up so the audience could see it. What it does is it highlights most of the changes that Mr. Decker mentioned in terms of areas, new wetlands and areas that were missed but have been extended. It also identifies some areas that are in, or what I think the two wetlands experts called gray areas, areas where you couldn't tell or they couldn't tell out in the field the exact boundaries, and be those sections where I think at least Dave Cowan from Norman Associates felt that a spring review would be necessary, perhaps later on, just to confirm the exact boundaries in terms of whether or not there were wetlands there or not on the site. But with all that, if you want, I can just put this up on the stand here and have people come around first. Okay. Some of the difference in color. Some of the differences in colors are going to start to blur between the black and the green. But I think in terms of the new wetlands, I think Mr. Decker, Scott pretty much identified all of them. There's one area that was added that I don't think he mentioned, which was this little open water area next to the alder swamp on the northern parcel. And in terms of the gray areas, there was a section here in terms of the area where there could be some argument. There's an area up in the southern parcel that would extend into lot 5, I believe it is, down here. And there's a section between lots 4 and 3 and the northern parcel that would extend down where there's a question, a couple others like that. But what this does, especially at close distances, it helps to differentiate between new map wetlands, the areas that were mismapped, and then the areas where there's some questions on both the consultants' part.
I think that needs some clarification. If we can get these things are all on this map over here, and everything was picked up by survey. This was a sketch map that Dave Cowan of Normando and I actually kind of, it's Dave's product, but we worked together on it. Everything that's here has, we went out and surveyed Normando's flags. Our approach that day was Dave flagged the wetlands and the gray areas. For instance, this gray area down here is surveyed as this right here. It's difficult for us to, I'm talking about the wetlands people, to go out there and make sketch maps. What's on here is this surveyed. So don't get I think it might have been gotten lost there that this and this are different. This is all inclusive of this, but it has the benefit of being done by survey.
Madam Chair, if I may, Steve, one question, sure. Then I guess would be the area between lots 3 and 4.
It looks, I guess what it is, I'm not quite sure what that is, because when I was at his office, that was not there. This was, the best of my knowledge, is the way it's surveyed out, and this thing over here is this extended. In my opinion, this is a matter of translation of someone's of the drawing, because to be perfectly frank, I don't remember that Steve being like that. We were very careful to. I took a working, made a direct duplicate of his map, and took it to the surveyors, and I believe they've picked everything up. But the one thing I wanted to make clear was that this is this surveyed, and we just, as I said, first of all, that gray area or not, if we didn't want to get this off on track, I'm sure we would have some different opinions. And in fact, Dave Collin from Normando, he doesn't make a determination one way or the other, at least between he and I. He's not saying it is wetland or isn't wetland. He couldn't make a determination. And what we did was we called it wetland as wide as we possibly could. So that was our approach.
Thank you. Thank you, Steve.
Madam Chairman?
Yes.
At the very least, I would expect that the new map when it's presented go to Normando for resolution of the issues. There are some minor issues between the sketch and what is surveyed out, and I think we'd want their opinion of whether something is or is not a wetland.
I agree. Thank you for the suggestion. Yes, would you step up to the microphone?
My intention is I'm going to drop a copy of this off to Normando.
Great.
I don't have a copy of this in my possession yet. We just got it from the surveyors to the land planners today, and this
sure.
was just done today.
This was all very fast work. Thank you. Any other questions before I open the public hearing?
Only a comment, Madam Chairman, that at last it appears as though the wetland boundaries are beginning to settle on the ground rather than be up in the air. And I think that's important for any of the deliberations that we have as we take into the preliminary plan review and the wetlands alteration.
Agreed.
So I think that's great. That's a major stride forward that we have.
I agree. Yes.
One question. Now that we've got the wetlands adequately identified, are there any other features about this property that I don't want us to be focusing on one thing and then being blindsided by something else? Rock outcroppings, things like that. Have they been a part of the review? Sort of we're looking at the actual land that can be developed here? And are they going to be shown also on the soils maps that are being presented, or are they already? Rock outcroppings, elevations greater than 15%, those kinds of items. So we have a complete inventory of
right. We went out there.
A complete inventory.
That's right. We went out there in view of the site location law and looked for rare plants and animals and unique natural features and that kind of thing. And we found a threatened plant species that was down in this area within the wetland.
Mm-hmm.
There was also an abutter talked about a type of lady's tresses, a plant, and there are two forms. The form that was on the site is not a rare form. But at any rate, it was the rare species we found on the site was within the wetland and not where the road goes. It was down in this area.
Okay.
Did you also look for signs of nesting black ducks? One of the abutters did suggest that was in the southern part in the pond.
It wouldn't surprise me that black ducks nest out there. Essentially, the wetlands other than at the crossing are sacrosanct anyway in this process, and really.
And the state recommends, or Inland Fisheries and Wildlife recommend, that there be a 200 or 250-foot buffer around such a site.
I would not think that this one would. This one will probably be justified to have a Natural Resource Protection Act buffer, which is, there's a formula that's 25 feet plus parentheses twice the slope. It's going to be a 30-foot buffer, say, or something like that. And the same for this wetland here. This is the wetland of value on the property in terms of wildlife features. This would not rate a buffer like the Scarborough Marsh or something where they ask for 250-foot buffers. It's not in the state listing of habitats which deserve, so to speak, that sort of buffer.
Anything else before we open the public hearing? Thank you. There are no further questions or explanations. I will now open up the public hearing. Is there anyone from the public who'd like to speak? Yes, Dr. Sullivan.
My name is Richard Sullivan, and I just want to make several comments. First of all, I'm happy that this hearing will be continued for another month, since the public has just become aware of these final boundaries of the wetlands within just tonight, and so haven't really had a chance to react fully to them. I wanted just to make one other comment, and that is that in December I mentioned that I was aware of some wetlands areas in the center here, and I think that the map which you showed earlier reflects that additional wetlands area, which does not appear upon this map. So I would confirm from my own observations and from my own testimony in December that indeed there is a wetlands area in the center. And if this question can't be appropriately decided in the winter months, that, in my opinion, there's a significant enough question that we should wait until the spring and obtain a definitive determination on this area. Thank you.
Thank you. And Normando will be checking this map. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
Good evening. My name is Gregory Woodworth. I live at 12 Channel View, which is an abutting property next to an area that has been indicated there is a change in some of the wetlands. I would like to echo Dr. Sullivan's suggestion that indeed this public hearing be extended 1 month because of the changes that we have seen in the wetlands delineations. And I'm not sure if it is appropriate to ask a question. Maybe I can ask the board or Madam Chairman to ask a question. Specifically with respect to this property that is contiguous to the property that I own, does the change in the delineation of the wetlands affect the plans that have been put forth by Greater Portland Development Group with respect to the development of that particular piece of property?
Great. We will hold that question till the end, and then a representative can come up and answer it. I have it so noted.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yes, Louise.
I'm Louise Sullivan. This is like the team. I just have a question. When Timson and Sheps, who were the environmental people that we asked to look, came, one of the things that came up was drainage and septic systems. And it was noted that several of the lots in this area would not be appropriate. I had a whole list, which I think probably were written in the letter.
10 lots.
Right. Mm-hmm. Will that be addressed by the DEP hearing, or how does that question come up about not only wetlands, but the ability of the soils to accept on-site septic disposal?
Mm-hmm.
Is that part of the DEP?
The DEP. Steve, maybe you could answer that one.
Just briefly, in terms of septic suitability, that's something that the code enforcement officer has looked at once. We'll look at again for the final plan, final subdivision plan. But in terms of the hydrogeologic mm-hmm. capacity of the area, that's something that the town up to this point hasn't done, and that we don't anticipate doing in the near future. And so that's something that at least I would anticipate would be an issue that the DEP would look at.
Mm-hmm.
And if it becomes a major stumbling block for the DEP, that will affect if and when the applicant can come back
right.
for this planning board for final plan approval, since the applicant's going to need to get all of his local, state, and federal permits before they can come back for final plan.
Right. And in doing that, they would think about how this land falls away, and then the water from here drains this way and that way, and in the septic runoff is what I'm talking about. The water that would supposedly clean water that would come from those surface systems.
How far DEP looks at that, I can't say.
Yeah. Thanks.
But DEP does have hearings.
Mm.
You know, yes, citizens can request hearings.
We have received a notice of a hearing for that, and... Beg your pardon.
Okay. Anyone else? Yeah.
Good evening. My name is Tim Thompson. I'm at 6 Pine Ridge Road. First of all, I'd just like to mention, I think there might be a little, there might have been a little confusion about this public hearing tonight, because I heard about it a little bit third hand or second hand, and I think maybe one of the reasons why there's not more people out tonight is they might not have understood that it was a public hearing, but I might be wrong on that. My concerns tonight and the ones I wanted to voice are those that we've been voicing for some time, and that Ms. Sullivan mentioned a little bit, and the impact on this wetlands from the drainage issues. It's obviously an area that's got quite the history of being unsuitable for septic systems and history of failing septic systems, and this area may be even more susceptible to those problems than the other areas that they built on, because a lot of the topsoil has been stripped off. But the impact that this area, and it grows every time we look at it, it's almost like the county fair. It gets bigger every time we look at it. But, you know, this area here, if I heard him right, it's like 100 feet. Is that right? This area that this cul-de-sac road is going through, is that approximately 100 feet? Right here?
Yes.
That seems to be a pretty significant new impact where we're having a road going right through a newly found wetlands. And I would agree with Dr. Sullivan that there are some areas that we've identified and have been identified in the past that still don't show up on the map. So continuing concern that I have for making sure that we take the time necessary and possibly look at a spring review of this before we make a determination on where those wetlands are. And again, I'm wondering, I think a question that keeps coming up in my mind is what's the hurry here? If we've got such a big concern about this, I'm sure that we're almost through February now, and this project's been going on long enough, and I would strongly suggest that we wait and do that spring review. One of the things that was brought up tonight was that this is taking the most generous approach to delineating where the wetlands are, and that they are looking at not only complying to the ordinances that are in force now, but those that are pending. And I would, this has been brought up once before. I'm just wondering, it was mentioned tonight, maybe I could ask again the board to ask that question towards the end of the night, if that is in fact the developer's intentions to not only see that this impacts the existing wetlands ordinance, but the one that we're looking at some time getting through the town council. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Thompson. Anyone else from the public? Yes, sir.
Good evening, Madam Chair.
Good evening.
This is going to be like the movie Halloween. We're back.
But it's so quiet here tonight. It just doesn't seem like same old thing.
As a direct abutter, I did receive from the town a letter in the mail saying that this was a public hearing tonight, which is one of the reasons that I'm here.
And could you state your name?
Sure, I'm sorry. I'm Bruce Gasquet,
right,
and I'm a direct abutter to the proposed road. Here I live at 82 Hunts Point Road, which is the last house on the left-hand side before you go into the woods on Hunts Point Road Extension. And I'm here tonight to address my own selfish issues, finally, after trying to look out for everybody else in this. I'm not opposed to a second access to Hunts Point Road or into Broad Cove itself. I think we do need that, but I do have some serious concerns as a direct abutter here. Last time, at the last public hearing, I addressed an issue that I've got concerns about. There's a natural water course here in wetlands which run around and underneath my house and then dump into this drainage ditch that runs down the south side here, southeast side. My builder, Ibis Corporation, when they built my house, took elaborate precautions to make sure that I had adequate drainage facilities. It's natural water course. They did not try and block it up knowing they couldn't. Instead, they made, as I said, precautions to make sure it drained properly into this drainage ditch. I understand that the developer plans to widen this drainage ditch as well as possibly filling in here where this wetlands is, and I'm wondering what that's going to do to my property. I'm really not going to be a very happy camper if I find my basement, which is absolutely dry at this point, is suddenly filled with water due to this road. I do have a concern, too. Perhaps it should not be addressed tonight, but this newly proposed road runs within 35 feet of my kitchen window, and I'm just wondering what the town proposes or would propose in terms of buffering neighbor's privacy in an instance like that. It's not an instance where it's 100 feet away or 200 feet away. I think I'm the most direct abutter to this project. Peter Barris, my neighbor over here, has an acre lot. His house is situated further away. This is really going to impact my privacy as well. Mrs. Rand also had a question about ducks. I was the one that mentioned the black ducks. We have ducks frequently in this drainage ditch here in the spring, and I invite somebody to come down there in the springtime, and I think I can hear them every night and during the day there. Also, I know that that's a man-made ditch, but if somebody looks in that ditch in the springtime, I think you're going to see aquatic plants growing in there. Now, whether those are wetlands types of plants and whether those would be dug up, whether those are feedings for animals, I'm not sure, but I would like to bring this to the attention of the planning board tonight. As a direct abutter, I have a lot of concerns about paying $300,000 or whatever for a house there and wondering, will I have a dry basement? What sort of privacy will I have? What are we going to be doing, changing the drainage, the whole patterns of drainage in this area when we run a road through here? Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Gaskin.
Before you leave, Mr. Gaskin, your property has a large piece of ledge, doesn't it, right in the front? Is it in the front near the ledge?
Yes. It's got ledge, Mr. Most, all the way around it. There are shale outcroppings there. I didn't have my house tested for radon. It's probably just as well, because we're all going to die of something here, but I'm sure the meter's going back and forth like this, but you're absolutely right. There are extensive ledge and shale outcroppings in that area.
And then how does the water drain around your house again? I guess I missed that.
When Ibis Corporation, and I bought it as a spec house, this is only secondhand to me, they actually ran those 4-inch or 6-inch diameter plastic corrugated tubing not only around the perimeter of my foundation, but also underneath the foundation. On the other side of the house, that then drains via a 6-inch white pipe into that drainage ditch.
Okay.
And right in this area here, the green wetlands area, you can see where the water suddenly starts to go underground there. Now, what actual pattern? I've never mapped it, and as far as I know, the builder never mapped it, so I don't know precisely which way it goes, but I do know the precautions that they took at the time.
Now I understand what you're talking about. Okay.
Thank you.
And Mr. Gaskin, you think that there is another wetland to the right of the proposed road that is 35 feet from your kitchen window?
Yeah.
Right
well,
in there?
I believe the wetlands, and you all walked through it that day.
Yes,
I'm probably surprised a lot of you that didn't have long enough boots on. There's an area in here that has standing water for, I would say, most of the year, except for maybe the height of the summertime. And that's the area that then flows down underneath my house and then flows out into that drainage ditch on the other side. But it's definitely it's not as wet, I'm sure, as the extensive wetlands over here, but it's definitely an area that's going to be filled in. Also, if you remember, this entire back area here has extensive drainage problems right now. It's almost like a swamp back there and ponds. And I'm wondering, when they start filling here, will that cause even more extensive problems when this drainage cannot filter off down through here the way it is now? Something else you might want to take a look at. Thank you very
Thank
much.
Thank you. Interesting. Anyone else from the public care to address this? No one else? Well, I will close the public hearing tonight, and depending on the wishes of the planning board and the votes that we take, there is a chance that it will be open, depending on the vote. It will be reopened the next time, depending on how the planning board votes on the preliminary plan and extending this.
Excuse me, Madam Chairman. Is there some time allowed for some discussion before we decide whether to extend the...
Oh, absolutely.
I just want to, because I am not going to be able to speak at the next...
Right.
Perhaps the extension of the public hearing. I would like to cite the wetlands alteration permit standards, in particular number 4, which we find on page 37 of our ordinance, which says that will not result in damage to significant spawning grounds or habitat for aquatic life, birds, or other wildlife. Because I am associated with an organization which has been very strongly represented in advocating for wildlife and black ducks in particular, I would just like to comment further on nesting black duck populations. I think it is a significant wildlife habitat if there are nesting black ducks there. Black ducks are a decreasing population, and I think that this board should pay some attention to that and do a little more research on taking into account buffering or protection of such a habitat. And I think we need to document this a little further.
Thank you, Alice. Before we get on with anything else, we did have a question from Gregory Woodworth. If someone from a representative of the Highlands would be willing to answer that. I think Mr. Woodworth asked, in this contiguous parcel, does the changes that have occurred in the wetlands, what you have recently discovered, how will that affect your plans? Is that the question,
yes,
Mr.
Sir,
okay. If you can answer that.
Excuse me, Madam Chairman. I'm not sure which parcel that Mr. Woodworth was
Mr.
referring
Woodworth
to.
Lives up in adjacent to Phase 2. On Channel View.
Right here.
I believe that you said that there were some changes.
That's right. That's right, over here. It would have no impact on this adjacent parcel of land. The changes that were made were in this area here, and the wetland doesn't extend over to the parcel, so I can see where it would have no impact.
What's going to be built there? I can't see it from here. Is that a lot?
Right here? This is lot
mm-hmm.
number 14, yes.
Well, depending on what's built there. There
yes.
could be impacts.
I guess I don't follow you, Madam Chair.
Well, that's all right.
There are spots on this lot where houses could be built. But I don't see that the addition of these two pieces of wetlands have materially affected any development with respect to this lot.
Okay.
While you're there with your pointer, just a question. On the road that comes off from Hunts Point Extension in Phase 1, yeah, you moved that road all
the way over to one edge of the allowable right-of-way, didn't you? Away from the house we were just discussing.
Sorry, Paul.
In our sidewalk, we discussed that. I don't, I'm just wondering whether the plan has reflected that.
No, the plan would reflect the roadway being in the center of the right-of-way. I'm not aware that there was any discussion about...
Remember that, Steve? We talked about where that roadway was going to come in, and we tried to set to make it less intrusive.
We did talk about that. I remember that.
I missed which lot you referred to, Iman. Or what section of...
Judith?
The last lot on the road, yeah.
From 14 Channel View?
Yeah.
I remember...
No, Hunts Point we're talking about, Steve.
Hunts Point.
Lot 62.
Lot 62, yeah. We talked about moving that road over to the extreme side of that right-of-way.
We talked, yeah, I remember talking about it on the sidewalk.
Recognizing that that lot was larger and that perhaps there was more room for...
Between the road and the house.
Right. And I remember Mr. Kennedy saying he was going to see, talk to town staff to see about moving the roadway over as much as possible. I think within his strip of land, I think he may be constrained. I think when we look at it further, I think it became apparent that he could only move it somewhat. I think it's not going to, by moving where the roadway's going to be located, it's not going to eliminate the problem that was mentioned. Because right now, Mr. Kennedy owns only a relatively narrow strip of land, which is big enough for the right-of-way and the road construction.
I thought that was one of the lots.
Yeah.
But the road, it's not a 50-foot right-of-way?
Yep.
It is a 50-foot right-of-way.
I believe so, yes.
And the road's going to be, what, 22 feet wide?
24, I believe.
The question was, could we move it all the way over and have 26 feet on one side? Instead of putting it down the center of the right-of-way, could we move it all the way over?
I remember being discussed in terms of the technical aspects of whether or not it could be done. I leave that to Mr. Decker to start to address.
Because that could add as much as 26 feet.
Well, half of 26.
Currently,
half of 26,
the typical section is 24 feet curb to curb, but there is a sidewalk planned also on the southerly and easterly side of the road. And with the sidewalk and the border strip that's required by the ordinance, that roadway section takes up most of the right-of-way. It could possibly be shifted 2 or 3 feet, but not much more than that, and keep the main parts of the typical section within the right-of-way.
Madam Chairman, back to the question might be, would a waiver be appropriate in this case to either move that and maybe perhaps move the sidewalk?
Is there anything we could do to buy some buffering space, is what I'm saying? Is there anything that you might want to suggest in your design to buy some buffering space in any area of a variance or something like that so we can make the situation better?
Yeah, there are possibly, shifting the roadway is certainly a possibility. It won't be able to be shifted much if we keep the sidewalk on the same side of the road that we have it now. How important that is, I guess that's not my decision, but yes, there are things that could be done.
It might be worth looking at, because we have a concerned neighbor here. There is a buffer problem.
Yes, Judith?
I remember distinctly from the sidewalk, and I'll admit, I think you probably have the lot that is really the most affected, particularly if that ends up being a through road. And I remember looking at it and thinking that the road was going to be on or very close to your turnaround. Isn't that right? The turnaround in your driveway?
The road comes very close to my property boundaries. As that strip goes back further into the woods towards Two Lights, actually, there's a lot more room there to maneuver that road away instead of running it just straight back. Now, I don't know where Mr. Kennedy's proposed lots start back there. In other words, there's a 50-foot buffer strip. How far that goes back before it actually hits Mr. Kennedy's lots back there, and can the road be skewed in this direction, at least taking it somewhat away instead of running it straight back? I don't know what the boundaries are back there, but I do know that the way my lot is situated, it passes very, very close to my property boundary, my garage, my kitchen window, in the back of my lot.
Your house, your property, the improvements actually are fairly close to the sideline. Vis-à-vis your neighbor on the other side, which is, has much, much greater distance. I would be willing to entertain some kind of a variance or waiver of something to move that road over or reach out some other kind of conclusion with respect to buffering, because that road is going to be right in his lap.
Obtrusive, to say the least. Any other?
This is probably a plan issue, preliminary plan issue, not a wetlands issue, but
right.
Something that we'd just like to have you think about.
One of the numerous things, Mr. Decker.
There are a few.
Madam Chairman.
Thank you.
If
yes.
I could ask through the chair that the applicant at least evaluate the, to answer the question about whether or not a subsurface drainage system in a house nearby would be likely to be affected, or some positive statement from the applicant during our public hearing process next time, having thought that through and having answered the question about whether there would be any effect on that adjacent property by what they're proposing to do, that would be appreciated.
Yes. We will ask about that next time. We will all make a note of that. In all of this, there are so many details, it's so easy to forget. But this is certainly an issue. Anything else on this wetlands permit? Any questions? Yes.
I have a motion, if you would like to entertain one.
Sure.
Okay. Be it ordered that the Planning Board votes to extend the public hearing on the request for a Planning Board permit for wetlands alteration for the Highlands at Broad Cove proposal until a regular March 20th, 1990 meeting.
Okay, is there a second to that?
Second.
Okay, any discussion of that? Actually, that is very related in the B part of what we're doing, the preliminary plan review, because what, depending on what we do, on the preliminary plan review, that will affect what we do if we do continue with a public hearing. It's the clock is ticking. By all rights, we are scheduled to vote this evening, 30 days after the public hearing. Unless we hear from the applicant that they would like to take more time, and we agree to that, then we are obligated to vote. What do you think of that?
Just a procedural issue. You should probably appoint Ms. Wyman here as a voting member.
Oh, thank you. I forgot that everyone else is absent. Judith, would you please be a voting member? Thank you. Anything else? I mean, I guess we are talking about procedures.
We do have a motion on the table.
The two are really related, and that's why I wanted to kind of have a little discussion on what we think we should be doing.
Madam Chairman, I read Mr. Frinsco's February 16th letter as indicating that it would be he was suggesting that it would be appropriate, and I'm reading from his letter, to defer Planning Board action on these matters until the next scheduled meeting following the next meeting of the board. And then the letter goes on to say this would also include a tabling of the scheduled February 20th, 1990 public hearing on the wetlands permit. We didn't table, we're extending, and I think that's the appropriate course of action. And I read that letter to indicate that the applicant is asking for deferral until the next meeting for any consideration of either the wetlands application permit or the preliminary approval. Now, if that reading is incorrect, maybe the applicant can tell us otherwise.
I had hoped my opening remarks made that clear, and I apologize for not making it clear. The last
part of the letter also, Dick, it did refer to using the time we have this evening to deal with any issues that have arisen in your mind relative to the preliminary plan. We'd like to try to get from you comments that you have about the plan on the variety of issues that have been lingering in the air during the course of this proceeding, if we possibly can. But in all fairness, I think the answer to Mr. Tidman's question is absolutely correct. We would, provided that this process is moving properly, consent to, and I used the word table, Tidman used the word continue a determination on both the wetlands application as amended, which will be filed promptly, and the preliminary plan reflecting those amendments, which will be filed promptly, to March 20th, if that's the appropriate date.
Okay, so you are formally asking for an extension?
Consenting to it.
Okay. Okay, that's clear. So, any other comments or questions from members of the board?
We have a second on the motion.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
How do you want to deal with this?
Call for the question.
Take the two.
No, let's deal with one motion
right.
at a time. That's to extend the public hearing.
Any comments on that? Do you all agree that we should extend the public hearing?
Yes.
Alice?
I think it's very important to do that, to give...
Do you want to vote?
Steve, did you have a comment?
I was just going to say, if we could have the show of hands...
That's right. Oh, yeah.
Electrical.
Okay. All in favor of extending the public hearing, raise your hands. It seems to be unanimous, Alice. Okay. Now let's get on with the preliminary plan review discussion. Any comments?
Madam Chairman, I,
yes.
Following Mr. Frinsko's comment, I would only ask, there are a number of issues that are pending that have been discussed that I'm not sure we need to raise again. I think Mr. Frinsko is looking for new issues this evening rather than all of the issues that have been previously discussed,
mm-hmm.
and I would expect that would be the case. I guess the principal question I have is, given the nature of where the wetlands are now, whether there are any proposed changes to the preliminary plan to reflect the wetland boundaries.
I'll have to ask Scott to answer that.
Whomever.
Dick, are you asking, are we going to be making any modifications to the preliminary plans based on the new delineations?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
There will be.
Then, given that, Madam Chairman,
mm-hmm.
we just got to sit and wait for the new plans to come out. There may be
right.
lot lines that change. There may be modifications to drainage systems. There may be changes to roads. To try to attempt to raise new issues this evening, given the fact that there may be small modifications or major modifications,
mm-hmm.
we don't know right now, may be inappropriate. And to that end, I would move that we order that the Planning Board, with the concurrence of the Greater Portland Development Group, will not make a decision at this meeting on the preliminary plan for the Highlands at Broad Cove, a proposed 20-lot subdivision in accordance with Section 16.2.4, and will consider said preliminary plan at its regular March 20th, 1990 meeting.
Mm-hmm. Is there a second to that?
Second.
Discussion? Well, I would like to discuss it. I am disinclined to extend the time because of a lack of information. It has been 5 months. I cannot vote intelligently without information. I would be willing to extend if by the next time I could see a realistic plan that reflects in the number of lots, the wetlands that you're dealing with. I think I would agree to extend if I saw that the applicant who has these very wide roads in all of these wetlands did some sort of reconfiguration of not only the number of lots, but where the roads would be, how wide those roads would be. I think that it would be good to look at an alternative to the connector road that has been proposed because of the wetlands, and also because so many people from the public are very concerned about that road. And when this board makes a recommendation to the town council, I would like the public to know and the town council to know that we have looked at all of the options. Maybe that emergency access public road, it can never be a reality, but I think I would like to have it looked at. I think I would like to see a parcel donated to the land trust. There has been some vacillating on that. The 19-acre parcel was supposed to be donated, and now I hear that it is not going to be donated. And it seems to me that Broad Cove, if the applicant wants to be a part of Broad Cove, he has to look at this subdivision and say Broad Cove does not have any recreational areas, and provide that. I think the pedestrian trails are pretty skimpy. I would vote to extend if I saw that we had better ones that were connecting with the Greenbelt. I guess I could just go on and on. Maybe the rest of you would like to say something. I guess I'm saying I would like some new thinking that is realistic in the number of lots. We really liked the first plan with the 10 lots. And I think that what we have here are far more wetlands than Mr. Kennedy thought that he had purchased. And I would just like to see that taken into consideration.
Madam Chairman, yes. And to further your comments, but again, many of the things that you've just raised are the issues that we have before raised that are related to the extent of wetlands and are related to the design that has been proposed by the applicant, but they're not new issues. They are the issues mm-hmm. of concern. They are the issues of substance that the board has talked for the last, not only the last 5 months, but probably a much longer period of time. On the issue, strictly one of the issues that you raised, which is an issue that I brought up a couple of times, and that has been a request. And maybe this is what Mr. Frinsco wants to hear this evening, a reiteration of a request that some sort of public access easement along the southern boundary of the project in Phase 1 from Broad Cove extending out to Two Lights Road exists along the boundary of the wetland on the southern side, on the northern side of that southern wetland. The applicant has previously not agreed to do that. It has been expressed not only by myself but other members of this board. We're still interested in having that access through there. He still apparently refuses to do that, although I noticed in the last plan that was provided in our package there is a public access easement of 22 feet through the northern boundary, which I think answers some of the questions that we had for that portion. There's still a desire on my part to see a similar type of access along the southern or Phase 1 portion of the project.
Thank you.
Judith,
any other?
Madam Chairman, it would be helpful if the board members would help me and be a little more precise. I'm not sure exactly where Mr. Tinsman is speaking of, so I can take notes from Mr. Kennedy. The southerly part of the development is down here. You want to go out to Two Lights Road, is that correct? By some means other than the roadway?
Madam Chairman, just to... While Mr. Frinsco is there,
mm-hmm.
Paul, if you'll put your pen on the easterly portion of that Phase 1 project and extend it west to Two Lights Road, that's the area that I'm talking about.
Through these... I mean, to connect these, what are now private driveways somehow?
I'm talking about a pedestrian, and Mr. Kennedy is aware of the area. You may not have been involved at that time, but along the northerly side of the southern wetland, extending in an east-west direction through connecting, so that people can walk through there from Broad Cove to Tulites.
Oh, I see.
Have access.
Using Winding Way Road?
Mm-hmm. Not walking through the ladies' tresses, but beside them, buffered by a stone wall.
You folks may be able to work this out among yourselves, but if I understand what you're saying, he's talking about something along this wetland down here to get us out.
That's correct.
From here to Tulites.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That's correct.
Necessarily would run along the back of the lots.
That's correct.
Thank you.
Madam Chairman?
Yes.
Relative to that, something that has stuck in the back of my mind since the very first plan were the sizes of the lots on Section 1, the southern section. Originally, the two ponds, or at least the pond on the easterly side, which we went out and looked at on our site walk, it's a dammed up, it's almost like a skating pond, was part of what was going to be given to the conservation group.
Mm-hmm.
And I had thought, this is very nice. There's a place where you can go out and you can somehow compromise. There's a little, you can go out and skate with your kids or walk around after Thanksgiving dinner or whatever. And then in the subsequent plans, all of a sudden, what are virtually unusable, unbuildable, undo anythingable wetlands are added into the lots to make 7-acre lots or 5-acre, 4-acre huge lots. I think it was at the workshop I had, I spoke to Peter Kennedy kind of off the cuff going, what happened to my skating pond? And he said, well, it's not there anymore. That is something that would make this lady very happy to see that sort of thing. And combined with that, some kind of a pedestrian easement that would connect from the Tulites Road. I just don't see why those lots have to be that big. And then somebody gets to have that skating pond all for themselves. And the lady slippers.
Dresses,
sorry.
Well, you know, just to follow through, in the submissions from Skinner and Lamb on the community impact analysis, when the 19 acres were going to be conveyed, Mr. Skinner or Mr. Lamb commented on how this would adhere to the comprehensive plan and the whole idea, because people could use this area for recreation. Now, it would appear that there will be no recreation, and I can certainly understand what Judith is saying. A skating pond would be great. But the plan does not adhere to either the old or the new comprehensive plan.
May I ask the same question again, Madam Chairman?
Yes.
The location of the skating pond?
Judith,
pond,
maybe you could.
Most easterly, Paul, on the south, right there. Your finger's right on it, right there. That's the one I pictured. It's a dammed up alders, and it's quite large. That's as big as this room, bigger than that.
But there is another one on the westerly side.
There's another one on the westerly side, which I must have missed that day. My feet got really cold.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But originally, those were all part of this big conservation. And I thought that was very nice. It was wetland, you couldn't build on it. Everybody else had nice big lots anyway. And it seemed like a good way to compromise a great problem with the neighbors, which is a loss of recreation area.
I think that was back before we had this road system required.
That's right. It was on the very first when it was a through road.
That was when we just had the short mm-hmm. cul-de-sacs with no through mm-hmm. access. Lot 6. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yeah, Paul, while you're there, I think the question that's a spillover from the wetlands consideration is the effect now of the newly mapped wetlands on subsurface disposal. I think that's an open question. We're going to want to know whether there's any effect on use of subsurface disposal now that you've got new wetlands mapped, what the effects might be. Are these lots big enough now to accomplish that?
Yeah, we will, in the final review, have the soil scientist take those into consideration and report back to you on that.
Madam Chairman?
Yes.
Just to clarify, does Mr. Most want to have that information before preliminary plan approval or during the final plan stages? I just heard Mr. Frinsco mention. Just want to clarify that in my mind.
No, I meant that was in our final review before we submitted the amendment to you.
Okay, okay. So it'd be preliminary plan then.
I thought it'd be preliminary plan we should have.
Okay.
I'd like to see all that we have mentioned addressed before preliminary plan approval.
Madam Chairman, also, the applicant had proposed that there are so many proposals here for so many different ways of treating things on the land, including a proposal at one time for reorienting the Cove View Road area so that Hunts Point Road Extension wasn't a through street if this proposal was accepted with the streets that are the way they are. We've not seen that come. Our engineer had some concerns about the geometrics of that road. I would presume, because we have a new preliminary plan before us, that that has been rejected by either the applicant is not feasible or something. But I guess I would ask Mr. Frinsco or Mr. Decker to comment on whether they're still proposing something different than shows on the preliminary plan application.
It's my understanding, Dick, that at this point, Peter is not proposing anything different than what we have submitted. Yes, that was a thought at one point in time, but it has since been rejected.
By the applicant or by the town?
The town engineer, too, right?
We said it would be difficult, but it would have to be looked at.
Mm.
So the applicant made the suggestion and then has decided not to do it.
After reviewing it in depth, in more detail, shall we say, it doesn't appear to be as feasible as he thought it would be.
Okay.
Anything else?
Madam Chairman, I would just like to ask for a little further explanation as to how the applicant will, what he will use to slow the speed. I know there's a great deal of concern about Hunts Point Road. Is there now or going to be any proposal such as we discussed using stop signs, where those little where those roads come into Hunts Point, and even using perhaps an island or protruding into Hunts Point Road to make that last section of Hunts Point Road more private. Has there been any further thought given to that?
To my knowledge, there hasn't been, unless Peter has been discussing that with his traffic engineer further. I'm not aware of any details to that effect.
Madam Chairman?
Yes, Steve.
In my discussions with Peter, Peter Kennedy, he stated that he and his traffic engineer, Bill Ray, would be looking at that and contacting various town staff. Town staff have discussed it at one or two department head meetings, and I'm not sure if those contacts have been made. I do know that, you know, the locations aren't shown on the plans that have been submitted to date by the applicant.
So there may be some new forthcoming designs as far as that's concerned.
I mean, that's been an issue that town staff has, you know, have expressed, that if you're going to have the connector road to try and minimize the speed problem, we need to have a good set of stop signs placed in various spots, and there are some spots that are better than others. So That's something we're looking for the applicant to put on the plans to show.
Right, and while you're on traffic, before I made a recommendation to the town council concerning this road, I would have to know a whole lot more about whether Two Lights Road can take that kind of traffic. I would want to know, I think this, Mr. Bray, who is a very respected traffic engineer, studied that intersection on a Friday afternoon in August. I don't know if the counts that Mr. Bray took could really reflect the traffic on a recreational road, which I would assume would have to be greater during periods of recreation on weekends when people are off. So I am very concerned about that particular road because it has very soft shoulders, and I would just like more information on that because that is essentially a very dead-end road behind Pheasanton 2, and I would hate to have that road blocked in any way by congestion, attempting, I don't think the right turn coming out of the highlands of Broad Cove would be difficult. I would think that if the left turn going into the highlands during heavy periods of traffic could be dangerous. And we have the option of asking the applicant to construct ingress and egress lanes to make a road safer. I have to ask, is that going to be necessary in this case? I have a lot of questions that remain unanswered. I also brought up to the applicant last month that our packets are filled with inconsistent information. We cannot make intelligent decisions unless the applicant tells us what to take out of these packets. I have letters here relating to an 11-lot subdivision. I've got letters from two different traffic engineers with two different sets of figures. When we vote, we have got to know exactly what we're voting on. So I would hope that you would convey that to him. And if he is not going to donate the 19 acres, then I would suggest that he remove his community impact analysis information as well, since that would be faulty. Hope you, the 19 acres is the most fragile area. It really, I don't know if you could really do much recreation in there. It's at the top there, Paul, with the...
This lined area?
Yeah, those were the 19 acres.
13.378.
Yeah, they originally were going to be donated, which the public has stated really can't be used.
This area to be transferred to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust.
Yes, but we have heard now that he wasn't going to do that, right? And didn't he indicate to you...
I don't know where you heard it.
He's indicated to me that he's switching his thoughts on that, and we haven't seen that
in writing.
On the plans. The problem, the major issue that came up with respect to that was that at the last meeting, the Conservation Commission read their motion that suggested that the land, that wetlands area be donated to the land trust only if, along with that, there was a dedicated pedestrian easement that would follow
right
along the edge of the wetlands on the northern parcel. And Mr. Kennedy stated to me that he does not feel that that's appropriate and has proposed a different location for the pedestrian easement that would go along some of Pine Ridge Road extension up through one of two of the lots up there.
Well, the simple answer is Mr. Kennedy's intent to place this land with an entity that will, number one, desire it, and number two, protect it. If the trust won't accept it, Madam Chairman, we'll attempt to find some other public entity or public, quasi-public entity that will.
Good.
I don't want you to get the impression that this land has been withdrawn from an offer to preserve it. That has never occurred. The question is, which entity will accept it to preserve it?
Madam Chair, just to clarify, there's been some deliberations back and forth. I think the applicant stated some ambivalence as to whether or not he now wants to dedicate the land itself or if he wants to dedicate the fee, the
right.
lieu of fee. I think that the basic concern that I'm hearing is that let's just see, you know, let's see which one it is that Mr. Kennedy would like to go with and then decide.
I certainly would like to know so that we can either accept or reject this information on the community impact analysis.
Well, just remembering our site walk through that northern portion that is striped on the map there, I think our major point of discussion with Mr. Kennedy referred really to the need for a dry area to be able to walk across. Mm-hmm. And as we walked through it, it obviously was far from dry. And a pedestrian easement really does need some terra firma to walk on. And I think that is something that the planning board would like to see happen, that some sort of a dry area be allocated, whether it be to the land trust or to the town or whatever.
Anything else? Yes, I would think that it would be important to allocate a dry area since the children of Broad Cove really have nowhere to play in an open space, a large open space. And Skinner and Lamb had suggested that such a space be provided, which would certainly comply with the intent of the comprehensive plan. Yes.
Madam Chairman, I would move the question and suggest to the board that we hold further questions until we see what applicant-generated changes to the plan they intend to do, given the newest wetlands and the comments that have been received by him before, as requests from the planning board to fit this proposed development into an existing neighborhood. And so I would move the question the motion that I had made previously.
And did you set a time frame on that? What was that motion?
That was the regular March 20th, 1990 meeting.
Okay, great. So that would extend this for just 1 month, correct?
That's correct.
Okay. Well, I don't know. I'm very concerned about the lack of information that we have on this, but if something positive could come of this, I will vote to extend. Any other comments?
I guess the question has been moved. And
yes. Okay. All in favor, raise your hand. Against. I guess that was unanimous, Alice. Maybe we could take just a few minutes to address the amendment to a previously approved subdivision plan, section 16-2-5, while Mr. Frinsco is here. We now have, from book 7737, plate number 1, the old plan. And I would just like to point out, I noticed something, that there are some 240-foot rights, private ways, that do not appear on the plan that has been submitted to us. If you notice, between Hunts Point Road. What are these 40-foot rights of way? and could they be used in lieu of the lots that are being changed into roads?
You asked that question. We have no idea what we have title to. We do not know what other changes the developer made since that plan was recorded.
Oh, I see.
We understand that that plan has had a long and troubled history with this community.
So perhaps there aren't any rights of way now? Are you? Is that what you're saying?
I can't represent to you the I'm not aware of it. Our survey shows that he believes the most recent information is that what's left on land adjacent to these two phases. I cannot tell you any more than that.
Thank you. Perhaps they have been incorporated into adjacent lots. Would you think that would
be
the answer,
Judith? That's
what
they look like to me. They're not there anymore. Not in, at least using
not according to the plans that have been submitted to us. And
10-foot sidewalk is not there.
Any questions or comments? I find that the ordinance on re-subdivisions is a very ambiguous. I don't know by what standards we are to allow re-subdivisions. Do we go back to the standards of subdivision design? I don't know. There is no direction in that ordinance. And when you vote to re-subdivide, I mean, here we are voting to take lots and make them into roads. I don't know if that's legal or...
Madam Chairman,
yes.
the maybe to start to shed some light on the question, broad question, the section of the ordinance is not really clear and doesn't provide standards. I think it would be legitimate for the board to consider the general subdivision review standards it has in 16-1-1, and also would be most likely appropriate to apply as many of the general standards as you felt necessary and reasonable for this development. Again, Mike Hill is here if you, you want to ask him some specific questions, but I think generally speaking, you could apply any subdivision standards that would be reasonable to assure that all of your concerns would be addressed regarding any changes to this subdivision.
Does everyone have a copy of section 16-1-1? I think we should read it and see if I could start reading it. This ordinance is designed to promote the health, safety, convenience, and general welfare of the inhabitants of the town of Cape Elizabeth by encouraging and ensuring sound planning, the use of the environment under healthful conditions, the imaginative and orderly use of land, compliance with the goals and objectives of the comprehensive plan, and development that fits harmoniously into the existing natural environment and rural character. Now, if you change these lots into roads, are you achieving all of that alone? This could be a legal question that we have to...
Madam Chairman, Jimmy, just to clarify, perhaps, I think that I guess I was referring more to the standards in A through N, and there's a couple more that have been added. I think general adherence to the statement, the purpose statement.
Oh, A through N?
Right. The purpose statement's there, and it's important I think, A through N, plus one or two others regarding wetlands.
That this change will not result in undue water or air pollution.
Water, sufficient water availability, burden on existing public water, so on and so forth. I think, you know, those are the general standards that the board uses and has to apply when it approves any subdivision. In addition, but in addition to those, are the general standards that are located in section 16-3-1 on page 14 regarding things such as preservation of important natural features, dedication of land to the green belt, things of this nature. Again, I think within reason, anything that's here that you feel would apply to today's standards, and especially with related to how this would impact the new development as well as existing section, I think that's something that could be added in. Pedestrian safety, traffic safety, things of this nature.
Are we to have a public hearing on this also, according to the section 16-2-5?
We have been advised by our attorney that we don't need to have a public hearing. It's up to the planning board whether they want to schedule another public hearing. Yes.
I think this is truly a moot point. It's a fait accompli. This has already been done. There is already on record a new subdivision that takes these old Balfour lots, the old little Balfour lots along Hunts Point Road, and made them into what we now see as the new configuration with the new roads. This little road down here that we see between lots G38 and G36, I believe, is what's now Winding Way. This is quite a long strip. It's 1,200 feet or so, 1,300 feet or so from the westerly border. I don't see, this should have been done. What we're doing by reapproving or conforming the old should have been done 10 years ago. That's my feeling. And that it frankly will make all these people sitting on legal lots now instead of being on non-legal lots, which is what they're sort of on. We're going to make everybody happy tonight.
Well, that was a nice explanation. I've never heard such a good explanation of this.
Madam Chairman, I guess, again, it's still a clouded issue. I don't think it's clear by any means. I think with regards to Winding Way and the extension of the development onward, again, I haven't done the research, and I don't think the town attorney has. I'm not sure the applicant's attorney has either, to go back and find out at what point that was re-subdivided and if that was done in accordance with the standards it should have been. I think the question that was raised probably 2 or 3 years ago when this time before the current session when this development was brought up before the board, I think the town attorney at that time said that there is a re-subdivision issue, an amendment question, and you can deal with it somewhat retroactively by just lumping it in with your subdivision review. And I think that's the viewpoint that he stated again more recently, this most recent go-around, that you can apply regional standards as you see fit, but on the other side, you also could incorporate that re-subdivision issue that may have, should have, you know, probably, perhaps should have been done years ago into the current, you know, into this current proposal.
This is so complicated. I would suggest to the planning board, since we are going to take a month, on and extend the wetlands alteration hearing, I think we ought to take a month and have our attorney just glance at this before we make before we vote. I think that would be the thing to do since it is a cloudy issue. What do the rest of you think?
Well, I guess I need a little further clarification of the letter then that we received on February 12th from our legal counsel. and at the end of the last paragraph, it states that, as will be explained more fully below, it is the opinion of this office that the Highlands of Broad Cove project should be considered one subdivision.
That was on another...
Oh, that's another question.
Or is that another issue?
Yes, I had raised the issue.
Totally unrelated.
That's unrelated. I had raised an issue several meetings ago concerning the fact that this could be two subdivisions, really. And so we got a legal opinion on that. Any other discussion on this?
Madam Chairman, maybe just to clarify, since Mike's here, Mike Hill's here, I don't want to put him on the spot. Maybe we could ask him whether he would, has anything he'd like to say now, or if he'd prefer to do a little more research and get back to the board and write. Sorry, Mike.
That's all right.
This is Mike Hill.
Is your question now regarding the previously approved amendment to a previously approved plan?
Right.
Well, what Steve mentioned is absolutely right, and I think the key word is reasonable. The ordinance is not very specific
right.
to how this is to be accomplished. And whenever the ordinance is less than specific, that you're supposed to apply the reason, whatever is reasonable. And it would be reasonable for the board to look at those issues which, and those standards, which it would look to in reviewing any subdivision. And the for example, traffic impacts, you mentioned the pollution, et cetera. Mm-hmm. So those are the types of things that I think you should take into consideration on amendments to previously approved plan, and other than that, I don't have much to add to what Steve said.
Thank you. Well, there are so many standards, perhaps we need several months to review this re-subdivision issue.
Well,
I'm only kidding about that.
I don't know. I just, those issues which you feel may be raised by the, or what effect these roads may have on that subdivision. The traffic is, to me, an obvious issue. But those issues which are reasonable under the circumstances is what you should look at and the criteria to be applied.
Okay, thank you.
Madam Chairman,
yes.
To the issue of whether this is something new then and is coming forth without a lot of forethought or a lot of public notice, this is part of the subdivision review process we're going through now. I raised the issue initially when this application first came in, and only to the extent that I questioned whether there were legal requirements that we may not have in a normal subdivision process. What I'm hearing is that there are really none, that mm-hmm. it is not a clear picture, if there's any picture beginning to focus at all, and that and the concern is really that the people know about it and that they know what the plans are, that they have the opportunity for input, and that we look at all of the technical issues that we possibly can. I think the re-subdivision issue is one of changes that occur by the developer and without public input, without public scrutiny with those changes.
Mm-hmm.
There is a lot of public scrutiny on this proposal. I'm pretty convinced that my answers have been, or my questions have been answered,
mm-hmm.
that it's not as much an issue of someone trying to hide something. It's an issue that's clearly out in the public purview. And to my own mind, I'm not sure that we have to go much further on this re-subdivision issue unless there's a clear legal requirement that we have to cross the T's and dot the I's, and I'm mm-hmm. hearing there are none.
Mike,
no,
could you...
Yeah, I'm in agreement with what Mr. Tinsman just said. That there, as in my mind, you're all said, you've done what the ordinance sets forth, and there are no other legal requirements other than what's in that section of the subdivision ordinance that the... I believe it states that the previously approved plan has to be submitted, which I understand it has been. So.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Do I hear a motion? What do you want to do about this?
It is an issue that's on our agenda.
We don't have to resolve it tonight.
I'm not sure that there is any resolution.
Is there, do we need to resolve that?
I don't have to. I think as long as at some point it's